ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. Brothers and sisters in Islam, as we navigate the life we are living, each one is having a style, and he is trying to find his comfort zone in the style that he adopts in this world. Although during our lives there are some static changes that have to take place due to your age. When you become old, your health is not the same. When you have children, you're not as free as you used to be. So you go through a cycle of changes, yeah, you change as you go. But there is one static, set, unmuted reality, which is this life is going to end one day. And you're going to experience one of these two dual experiences when it comes to death. So the static reality, which unmuted, it will never change, regardless of how much you create your comfort zone in this world or not, you will die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with this language in the Quran. إِنَّكَ مَيِّتْ. Is not, even if you carefully translate the words, Allah is not telling him you will die. Allah is telling him you're dead. إِنَّكَ مَيِّتْ. The word مَيِّتْ in Arabic means dead, someone who is dead. You are dead. وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. And they will die. Something so amazing, ya ikhwa, about our religion, the vivid, clear picture of events which unfold before the eyes of the living who are surrounding the deceased. Subhanallah, not necessarily you're gonna see every single event, but you see them when you see a person dying, or when someone describes for you the nature of his death. Subhanallah, this is what the Prophet said in the Hadith. Subhanallah, this is what Allah said in the Quran. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a way, he detailed the events of death in a very vivid manner, as if you see it. As if you see it. It's not something that you speculate. Because in principle, as Muslims, you cannot speculate or produce anything pertaining to the unseen without having an evidence. You can't speak of the unseen without having قال الله قال رسول الله, because you haven't seen that. As a matter of fact, we go farther that you cannot use analogy either. You cannot do qiyas in al-ghaybiyat. You can't say, okay, because the deceased does that, then he can do that. You cannot do that either. أصول الفقه يقول لك لا, you can't do that. You cannot do that. لا قياس في غيبيات. Because you don't know the wisdom behind it. How are you going to utilize آلة العقل, the rational here? Brothers and sisters in Islam, let me go through the journey. Of course, you don't know when it will end. There are some signs. There are some signs. Ulama, the scholars of tafsir, they mention these signs in explaining this verse in Surah Fatir, where the disbelievers are in the hellfire and they are requesting to come out and go back to this world so that they can do a better job than what they have done, which really resulted in them being in the hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to their request by saying, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُوا فيها من تذكر وجاءكم النذير. Having already placed you in it, not only that, we sent you warners. The scholars mentioned one of the warners is the death of your parents. If your father died, that means you're next. Or the death of your older brother. If your older brother dies, then you're next. That's a warner for you. That's a warner. That means you're next in line. Two, Nadir is the messenger. The scholar mentioned, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi hadith ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, radiyallahu anhuma, he said, مفاتح الغيب خمس, there are five keys of unseen. Only Allah knows them. There are five areas. The knowledge of these areas is exclusive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he recited the last verse in a chapter, Luqman, I think chapter 32, if I'm not mistaken. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثَ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ. Here it is. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدَى وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٍ. You don't know whether you're going to live until tomorrow so that you can actually accumulate some more wealth, or you don't know where you will die and how you will die. So the knowledge of it is taken away from you, but it's a fact, it's a reality that you actually have to be prepared for at any time. But out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah send you the warners. Another warner the scholar mentioned, brothers and sisters in Islam, they said the gray hair. When your hair actually begins graying, when you see that in your body, even if you died, by the way, if you go ahead and died, it doesn't matter. It's still gray. I mean, it's a sunnah to die. It's actually a sunnah, an established sunnah. There is nothing wrong with it. As long as you're not doing the black color, you're doing an alternative color here. But when you see that, another one, when you reach the age of 60, or you're close to it, when you're hitting the age of 60, that means what? Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned fi hadith Abi Huraira radiyallahu anhu fi sunan al-Imam al-Tirmidhi, a'maru ummati bayna al-60 wal-70 wa qalilun minhum man yujawizu dhalik. The lifespan of my ummah is between 60 and 70. The majority of the Muslims will live between 60 and 70 years old. But some will cross that line, some. But we're using the majority here, the overall, number of Muslims. So basically, if you live until 60 and you're still alive, I'm sorry, you're living in that wasted time. You know, when they play soccer, they add 5-6 minutes at the end of the game. Huh? So that's the wasted time of the game. So how come you're not ready? Well, look at the other hadith. أعذر الله رجلا أبلغه 60 سنة. Allah given, subhanahu wa ta'ala, given enough excuse, enough chances to someone, Allah made him live until the age of 60. Why? Because he should know that at any moment now, you should be ready to go. And other warners, brothers and sisters in Islam, but the shahid is, be prepared, be ready, even in the absence of these warning signs that you should receive, indicating the nearby end. But subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger indicated that the majority of people, although they know death is a reality, but they are in a state of ghafla, heedlessness. They act like it doesn't exist. It's like you're driving on the highway and you know the speed limit is 60. You know it, but you're driving what? That's what you call heedlessness. You know it's a fact out there. When will you wake up? Huh? When you find a policeman with the light. You're like, oh, man. Well, at the time of this, لَقَدْ كُنْتَ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مِّنْ هَذَا فَكَشَفْنَا عَنْكَ غِطَاءَكَ فَبَصَرُكَ الْيَوْمَ حَدِيدٌ. وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ ذَلِكَ مَا كُنْتَ مِنْهُ تَحِيدٌ. After that, لَقَدْ كُنْتَ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مِّنْ هَذَا. You were heedless about this, although I sent you messengers and all of that. Well, the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was the first to use PowerPoint. Seriously, the Prophet used PowerPoint. One day, in the sand, he drew in a triangle like this to his Sahaba. That's a PowerPoint. And he placed a dot in the middle and a line that crossed that triangle. Then he, a square. Well, it was like a triangle. What is the other thing, the four angle? Whatever it is. Yeah. So he said, this is the human being. This is the human being. And the end of that line that crossed the boundary of that triangle, and he said, this is how much hope he has in this world. But this is his death, right here. يَقْطَعُ أَمَلَهُ. His death comes here. So you would be planning, okay, I gotta build that thing, I gotta have that mansion, and I wanna have that private jet, and I want the kids to do that. And there is a line out here that it's over. It's over. Wake up call, brothers and sisters in Islam. I mentioned something called the dual experience. Basically, I want to give it to you this way. I want to give it to you this way. When you were fetus in the womb of the mother, after 120 days, based on hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud fi Sahih Imam Muslim. The hadith is authentic. I don't want to go through citing it because it could distract me from moving forward. That after 120 days, an angel comes and he writes how long you're going to live. One of the things that he writes four things. One of them, how long you will die, the time you will die. So the soul is blown in that flesh, fetus. Then you come out. Now, one day, this soul is going to be called out of your body. Now, the angel of death, when he comes to announce your death, he's going to call your soul out of the body. Now, he's going to describe your soul with one of two descriptions. There is no third to them. I haven't found a third description. يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الطَّيِّبَةُ يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْخَبِيثَةُ. That's the dual right here. Oh, pure good soul come out? And in the Quran, at the end of Surah Al-Fajr, rested soul, ya ayyatuha nafsu al-mutma'inna, or wicked soul. There is no third. So imagine now, you came into this world with a pure soul, ready to go both ways. You are on a mission in this world to prepare that soul for the angel of death, to call it good soul. That's what you're trying to do. And if you're not doing that, rest assured that the soul may be called with the other description, the wicked soul. And by the way, don't assume that only apply this, the call of wickedness or filthy, actually, I read some translations, or filthy soul, that is exclusive to disbelievers or hypocrites. No, disobedience Muslims, they may be called that. Yes, this will be counted as expiation for their sins, even if they get punished in the grave, even if they go to hell. But we know at the end of the day, because they are Muslims and they are from the people of Tawheed, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, they will be admitted to Jannah sooner or later. Sooner or later. But a disobedient Muslim can be called that. Ya ayyatuha an-nafsul khabitha. This is you're making that decision now. Every single day you live in this world, you're making that decision. Whether you want that soul to be called with the descriptive tayyiba, mutma'inna, good, pure, rested, or wicked, filthy soul. Brothers and sisters in Islam, another thing, whether you will love to meet Allah or you will hate to meet Allah, again, a dual experience here. You're making that choice now, by the way. Every day you're making that choice. At the bed of death, this will be displayed. And for you to reflect upon this, في صحيح الإمام البخاري, عائشة رضي الله عنها is the narrator of this hadith, that one day Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said in front of her, من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه ومن كره لقاء الله كره الله لقاءه. Whoever loves to meet Allah, Allah will love to meet him. But whoever hates to meet Allah, Allah will hate his meeting too. Now we know the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, including our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, they know the only way we're going to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is after we die. You're not going to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world. That's a semantic in Islam. It's unchanged. It can't change. One of the fundamentals. She said to him, so for me to love to meet Allah, I must love death then. That's why she said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, wa ayyuna la yakrahu al-maut. And who doesn't hate death? We all hate death. Even awliyaullah. And if you look carefully, the hadith, man aada li waliya, whoever has animosity against my wali, my friend, read that hadith carefully. At the end of the hadith, وَمَا تَرَدَّدْتُ فِي شَيْءٍ كَتَرَدُّدِي فِي قَبْضِ رَوْحِ عَبْدِ الْمُؤْمِنِ يَكْرَهُ الْمَوْتِ. وليه ولي الله يكره الموت. He hates death.
To Greek philosophy or علم الكلام, speculative speech.
He hates death. ولي الله, he hates death. So we all hate death. Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم corrected her understanding. He said, يا عائشة, not that. But when the believer is about to die, he had a total different experience. The angels who come, very cheerful, very good looking. They are smiling. They come and comfort that person. they give him glad tidings. You did good. You purified your soul. You succeeded, man. You did it. Yeah. Actually, this is a group of angels who arrive before the angel of death. You see, the angel of death is so busy. He comes to, right, yalla, next soul. But these angels, they arrive at the scene before. And if you want to validate that, the man who killed 100 souls, the two groups arrived, actually. Because technically, he's a killer. But because of his intention, the angels of mercy also arrived. And they quarreled. They started arguing. No, he's ours. No, he's ours. But the angels of mercy, brothers and sisters in Islam, they give that person glad tiding. Well, Quran sawar hada. The Quran illustrated this in a beautiful way. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا. Don't be afraid of us. We're here to help you. We're here to make it possible. You know, I hate to give this resemblance, but I remember when I was doing my ACL, the surgery, I get that anesthesia provider coming in. We're going to give you a shot. You're not going to feel anything. The shot is going to be easy. You're going to go to sleep. And when I wake you up, you're going to be just fine. That's exactly what it is. Exactly. That's exactly what happens at death. That's why the believer, by the way, immediately what? Okay, let me go. Can we go? Then he loves to meet Allah. I want to go to Allah then. وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوَعَدُونَ. The Jannah that you promised. So at this stage, the believer what? Detached. The world, this world becomes what? He's not even considering it. Let me go. And that's why his soul comes what? But look at the other dual experience. Again, brothers and sisters, the point I'm trying to make here is you're preparing for that scene as we go, as we progress. Are you praying 5 times a day? Yes, then you're doing good. No, don't think that there will be any compromises here. You know, if you're going to hope, you have to hope with striving, with trying. But don't just sit at home and say, Allahu ghafur rahim, no problem, Allah will forgive. La, la, la. We call this wishful thinking, amani. Laysa bi amani, like the Christians. Huh? They're, what is this? Jesus died, khalas. Yeah, we're going to try. But he's already did it. God sent his. And actually, they believe Jesus is God. So God came down and killed himself, suicide for us. You know, look at this. The human intellect can go to. You're making that decision. That's the point I'm trying to make. You're making that decision now. You're making it. Take this serious. This is not a game here. This is not, you know, if you believe, this is how the Prophet described this scene for you. And brothers and sisters in Islam, your certainty regarding these particular events really is enriched when you visualize it. كما يقولون الإيمان بالشيء فرع عن تصوره. Were you able to visualize it? Look at the other one. Oh, wicked soul. Awful, filthy soul. Imagine the soul will escape into the body. Will run. He doesn't want to die. He doesn't want to die. He will hate to meet Allah. Allah will hate his meaning. And that is why these angels will have to do what? To beat the deceased. وَلَوْ تَرَى إِذْ يَتَوَفَّى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَضْرِبُونَ وُجُوهَهُمْ وَأَدْبَارَهُمْ. They beat them in the face and on the rear. Get the soul out. Come on. You're going to get this. Also, brothers and sisters in Islam, subhanallah, when the soul is extracted out of the body, it goes through a funeral. Like the body is going to be followed by a human, angels follow that soul up. But there are two souls now, that you'll experience here. One soul, knock, knock, in that lower heaven. No, not allowed to go up there. That soul will be thrown into the seventh earth. كَلَّا إِنَّ كِتَابَ الْفُجَّارِ لَفِي سِجِّينَ The Prophet ﷺ recited this verse when he was narrating that piece in a famous hadith, hadith al-Bara ibn Azib, fil maut, one of the lengthy hadith, he recited this verse, وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَكَأَنَّمَا خَرَّ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَتَخْطَفُهُ الطَّيْرُ أَوْ تَهْوِي بِهِ الرِّيحُ فِي مَكَانٍ سَحِيقٍ مكان سحيق depth of earth شوف الآية هذه في الأعراف يقول لك إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا عَنْهَا لَا تُفَتَّحُ لَهُمْ أَبْوَابُ السَّمَاءِ Those who were arrogant and they didn't want to submit the sky, the heavens, the gates of the heavens are not going to be open for them. Again, but look at the other one. We'll go to the seventh heaven, to Allah. And actually we read, and this is authentic, brothers and sisters, that this soul is going to meet already the other souls that died and they are there. There is a hadith of Abu Huraira. And they're going to ask about their family. What happened to my son? Is he doing good? Did you see him? Oh, he died. That means if he's not there, that means he's where? That's why they become sad over them. طيب, in the way to the grave, in the way to the grave, huh? Likewise, which one? Duel. That's also another illustration of your love to meet Allah. حديث أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه في صحيح الإمام البخاري قال صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا حملت الجنازة على أكتاف الرجال when the janazah is being taken to the cemetery فإن كان صالحا if he is good he will say what قدموني قدموني let's go come on why are you guys taking your time here rush move on he will go to the grave He want to go to the grave. He's in a hurry. He wants his janazah to go in haste. He's longing to the grave. What a feeling. But the other one, and if he wasn't, Ya waylaha, Ya waylaha. Slow down. Where are you taking me? Come on, guys. Why are you rushing? Take your time. Where are you taking me? But again, brothers, I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to let you know that every single day that goes by, you're making that decision. Which experience you want to have. You see, there is a dual experience with death. You can see it throughout, by the way. I don't know if time is going to allow me to go through it. But you're going to find this throughout death. That dual experience. Now, every day goes by. That's my message again. I don't want to waste my time here in scaring you, but you see, this is a call for a spiritual wake up for all of us. You're deciding which experience you want to have. Every day goes by. Top in the grave after burial. Subhanallah, ya ikhwa, the only confirmed connection between the deceased and the living is right after burial. Actually, the deceased, hadith Abdullah ibn Amr, hadith Amr ibn al-As, وهو في سياقة الموت, hadith al-Bara أيضا, that after the people bury the dead, and as they depart, he hears the shuffling of their feet, you know, the sound of their feet. And here is a sunnah that we should implement. And this is actually part of the wasiyah. It's Imam Muslim. which Amr ibn al-As رضي الله عنه given to his children, he said to them, and after you bury me, stay next to my grave because I want to feel your company. فإني أستأنس بكم. But again, brothers, we cannot use analogy to say then the deceased can see me. No. You see, in ghaib, no analogy. That's a confirmed record right here. We have an evidence that after burial, the deceased has a connection with the living. Then those two angels arrive. You know, they are not easygoing angels, by the way. That's why في الصحيح صحيح البخاري أسماء, the sister of Aisha, بنت أبي بكر رضي الله عنهما, is the one who narrated this hadith. There was a eclipse salah, and she came, and you know what the eclipse salah, the Prophet given a talk that day, and then he given a talk that people, some of them actually fainted, but one of the things that she remembers that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, what, inni qad uhiya ilayya أنكم تفتنون في قبوركم مثل فتنة المسيح الدجال. It was revealed to me that you will be tried and tested in the grave similarly to the fitna of the Antichrist. طب, what is the relevance here? The relevance is deception, is the intimidation. The Dajjal is going to intimidate you if you come near him. The deception, these munkar, look at their description, their eyes, their color, their, and the way they interact with the deceased. They are not going to come and wakey wakey, time to have your cereal. No, they're not going to do that. They're going to scare you. Even if you give the right answer, they will still confuse you. Are you sure? You're going to say, my Lord is Allah. I say, no, no, you're not sure. You're not sure. Are you sure? Are you sure? Well, like, who will succeed the test? Who will succeed it? First of all, the one who receives the steadfastness from Allah. When the Prophet ﷺ narrated that portion, that scene, that event, he actually recited this verse in Surah Ibrahim, قول الله تعالى, يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. Allah will grant the believers steadfastness. My Lord is Allah. Are you sure? Yes, I am sure. Yes, I am sure. But the other, no. The similarity also, brothers and sisters in Islam, is the field of test, tawheed, the fundamentals of the religion. You see, the angels are not going to ask you when you are in the salah, although this is important, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي, do you raise your hand or not? No, no, no. Who's your Lord? Fundamentals. Fundamentals of the religion. Likewise, the Dajjal, he's going to come and test you in the area of what? Tawheed. He wants you to worship him. Again, brothers and sisters in Islam, that you... look at this, a divine public announcement. SubhanAllah, the first time I came across this, I was preparing for my lecture, my khutbah, that this announcement is going to be made public. That if you say, my Lord is Allah, my religion is Islam, and my messenger is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I learned this from the book, a heavenly call, announcement. صدق عبدي, this man spoke the truth, this man did good, now his grave is going to be transformed into a meadow from Jannah. That piece of earth 6 feet under, which filled with sand, is going to become a Jannah, is going to be open to Jannah. Again, brothers and sisters, Islam, pay attention here. That's why the Quran called that place barzakh. Barzakh. The word barzakh is used in the Quran in Surah Ar-Rahman in a different context. What is the context? مرج البحرين يلتقيان. Allah made the two seas meet. The fresh water and the salty water. You see, they don't mix. What they form? They form a barzakh, a barrier. Now, this barrier has the characteristics and the attributes of the salt water and the fresh water. Likewise, the grave. It's an earth. But it has also the characteristics of the next world. There are things that happen there that you don't see. Because Muslims, some Muslims, the intellectual, huh? We go open the grave, yeah, there is nothing there. What? There is a part there that you don't see. عالم الغيب. You do not see. Barzakh. But look at the other one. He spoke, he's lying. Turn his grave into a pit from the pits of fire. Wallahi, you know, one of the most fascinating things and is how you employ Hadith Anas with this next event, which I'm going to close with, inshallah. You see, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said what? Hadith Anas, that's in Muslim. يَتْبَعُ الْمَيِّتَ ثَلَاثٌ. Three things, three items, follow you to the grave. Two come back and one stays. Family. What is the other one? Wealth. And amal, whether good or bad. The two, the family and the wealth, will come back and your amal is with you. Look at the next scene. When the righteous person and answers these questions correctly and his grave now is a meadow from Jannah. You see, we're still human. I mean, you can be living in the best place in the world, but by yourself, that's not fun. You see, when Adam was placed in Jannah, Adam was in Jannah, but he felt like I'm alone here. So Allah given him what? A companion. Because we're a social, we call species. You want to be around people. So although he's in the middle of Jannah, he's enjoying things, but he feels lonely. By all of a sudden, this good-looking man appears to him. I'm not making up that stuff, brothers. This is for Sunnah, authentic. Very good-looking, cheerful. And he will come to him and say, Abshir, man, I'm here to give you the glad tiding. You really did good with your life. You know, you were presented with that opportunity to take mortgage from the bank and pay usury. And you said, Astaghfirullah, no, I'm not going to do that. You were presented with the idea of smoking a joint. I said, Astaghfirullah, no. To drink, to get, no. Adult, no. You said no to that. You did good. Then the deceased will say to him, your face is a cheerful face. I love you. Who are you? I don't know you. أنا عملك الصالح. I'm your righteous deeds. I'm your five daily prayers. I'm your salah at night. I'm your zakah. I'm your donations. I'm your taking care of your children, taking care of your family. I'm your honesty. I'm your truthfulness. But he says something also very interesting, brothers and sisters in Islam. He actually takes oath to him. Wallahi, by Allah, ما علمتك إلا سريعا في طاعة الله بطيئا في معصية الله. I only knew you quick when it comes to the obedience of Allah and slow when it comes to the disobedience of Allah. Again, likewise, an awful looking, scary looking person will appear to the wicked man. Who are you? I'm your wicked deeds. I'm your lying, I'm your cheating, I'm your backbiting, I'm your adultery, I'm your intoxicants, I'm your not praying five times a day. I am. again, my message to you, every day goes by. Although you may be able to control the changes that you experience, but there is a static fact that you will face that. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواج أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. عبد الله بن قيس أبو موسى الأشعري, the companion, the prophet one day said to him, لقد أوتيت مزمارا من مزامير آل داود. يا عبد الله, Allah giving you a voice that recites the Quran similar to داود. Beautiful. وهو في سياقة الموت, when he was dying and his children are surrounding him, he would become unconscious and he would gain his conscious again. By the way, this author is authentic. في مصنف ابن أبي شيبة, authentic. Then he looked at his children. فقال يا بني, my children, اذكروا لي صاحب الرغيف. Talk to me about the companion of the loaf. Bread, loaf. صاحب الرغيف, the owner of the loaf. قالوا يا أبانا وما صاحب الرغيف. Sorry father, we don't know that story. Then he said, I heard the prophet narrating this to me one day. He himself said that. He narrated it then. He said, there was one of the people from Bani Israel on Tawheed, the monks. You know, the people who fled the distorted Christianity and the persecution. The Christianity Christians are living now, brothers and sisters, and waiting for you to wake up to give them the right message. But this man, he worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 70 years non-stop. Imagine worshiping Allah for 70 years. And he would designate half a day every week to go to the market to buy shopping, his needs for the week. For one of these days, he's walking down the street, a beautiful woman, whether she's beautiful or not. Shaitan, subhanAllah, when a woman walks out not dressed properly, Shaitan looks at her. How can I use you? How can I use you? إذا خرجت المرأة من بيتها متبرجة استشرفها الشيطان. How can I make a good use of you? And he would actually get your eyes to like her. وقع عليها سبع ليال. Imagine, he ended up committing adultery with her 7 nights, 7 days. That shows you, إخوة, you can come down from. You will be righteous and pious. He felt so guilty after that. He wakes up. Man, what I'm doing? Astaghfirullah. What is this? Astaghfirullah. So he wakes up. Then he legislates something upon him that is out of this world. He would take one step. He would go down to prostrate in the ground every step. And he would say, Astaghfirullah. Tubtu ila Allah. And he would, every step. He kept doing this for the whole day. He is dead tired. From a distance, he saw people standing, poor people standing, masakeen. What is the story of those people? 12 miskeen, 12 needy, poor individuals who come to that place every day at sunset, a rich, righteous, generous man would bring to each one of them a loaf of bread. That day, subhanAllah, so now they're number 13. This man arrived late. So he started distributing the loaves of bread. Here you go, here you go, here you go, here you go. This monk, this man, received one loaf. That means what? There is one miskin who did not what? Get his loaf. So that miskin said, I'm hungry. I said, listen, I brought the 12, I given it. They don't realize that there is a 13 there. So the man, what am I going to do? I'm starving. So this man calls upon him. He was so tired to stand up. He said, Ya hada, oh so and so. This was dark. Nobody knows who he is. Oh so and so, this is your loaf. I took it by mistake. وَمَاتَ مِنْ سَاعَتِي Then he dies right here. They placed the 7 years consistent worship in the scale and the 7 nights of adultery, the 7 nights of adultery. They placed that one deed in front of the 7 nights of adultery. That one deed outweigh the 7 nights of adultery. One deed. Why Abu Musa requested to hear that? Hope. Hope in Allah. You see, I'm asking you to always, you know, pray, do the right thing, but always pair this with hope in Allah. You see, this is the ground that you need to hope. But if you hope without that, you're lying. You're lying to yourself. اللهم ارزقنا قبل الموت توبة وعند الموت شهادة وبعد الموت جنة ونعيما يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن يا رب العالمين. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم أصلح لنا دنيانا اللهم أصلح لنا آخرتنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم وفقنا إلى ما تحب وترضى وخذ بنواصينا إلى البر والتقوى. أقول قولي